And here we take a presentable categories. Everything just, the pattern just repeats itself. So maybe I should first give a definition of what topos is.
It would be very abstract. suppose that E is a complete category. Oh, I'm sorry, co-complete category. I will say. Okay, so maybe I should draw the picture here. Okay, so here, poset. And then in the theory of posets, you can talk about, for example, the enthymem, the meet between A and B, or suprema. And of course, you have also enthymem, as well as supra-join. So this is called meet. This is just the finite, the enthymem when it exists between two elements in a poset is called the meet. Just a terminology, and this is called the join. Okay. Now, if you replace poset by categories, then you have also the same thing. Here, this is called co-limit of a diagram. So you have a diagram, and you take its co-limit. Here you take the limit of the diagram. And here you could take the co-product, or more, better, even the amalgamated co-product, and here you take the Faber product, let's say, of A, B, and C. Okay. I said that a category is, a lattice is called a soup lattice. It's a soup lattice means that soup lattice. Is a poset with suprema, arbitrary suprema. So that's the notions of a soup lattice, but there is a notion of co-complete category. It's a category closed under co-limits. So a co-complete category is very much like a soup lattice, if you like, in the world of categories. And there's also notions of a complete category. It's closed under limits. Okay. No, here everything small limits. I mean, you have a small diagram, and. Okay, for finite limits, I like to call that Cartesian. You don't like. I can say finitely complete.
Maybe I can object to closed under
co-limits. Oh.
Or closed. about yeah. clothes.
Yeah, yeah.
Which admit
clothes. Yeah, 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 yeah. It's like saying that the poset is closed under suprema. We could say with, yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's an abuse of language, right? Yeah, yeah, yeah. But yeah, in writing, I can make it straight, yeah. Yeah. But Grothendieck had the idea that when you take a limit of a diagram, you take it in the category of pre-sheaves. And if, so the limit always exists in the category of pre-sheaves. And if this limit is actually representable, then you say that the category is closed on the limit. So if we adopt the point of view of Grothendieck, we can use the word close, okay? So it's not completely wrong, okay? Yeah. Okay. So what is a presentable category? A presentable category is a bit of a technical notion. Roughly speaking, it's a co-complete category with generators, you see, a small set of generators. It's not too wild. It is generated in some nice way by a certain set, a small category inside. So I could take some time to explain you what is a presentable category, but I'm afraid that it may use a lot of my time. So I will suppose that this notion is known, but I'm writing some note, and I will make it give the definitions in the notes. So presentable. So an example of presentable category is that if you take a small category, then you take pre-sheaves on A, which by this I mean contravariant functor from A to set, which are of course also the same as covariant functor from A up to set. This is an example of a presentable category. In this case, the generators, it is generated by A. So that you have the unit I functor in the category of pre-sheaf. And these, every object, every pre-sheaf is a co-limit of representable. So that tells you somehow that the category of pre-sheaf is generated by A. But not only it is generated by A, but it is freely generated by A. It is freely generated. That's very important for the category of pre-sheaf. Exactly. Exactly. So what this means is that if you have a functor here from E into a co-complete category, then there is essentially a unique way to extend it into a co-continuous functor. But, I forgot to say what a co-continuous functor is. A functor is co-continuous if it preserves co-limits. It is continuous if it preserves limits. Okay. So given a functor from A to E, there is essentially a unique functor, f, a lower freak, which is co-continuous and which extend f. This functor can be described easily. It's called the left-hand extensions of f along y. That's a technical name. But it has a concrete description The reason is that if you take a pre-sheaf, then every pre-sheaf is a co-limit of representable but in a canonical way, which means that X is actually the co-limit over the diagram A over X. Let me write it like this, A from to X of YA. I'm sorry, of YA. Okay. I think it's Yoneda who first observed that any pre-sheaf is a canonical co-limit of representable. This indexing category here is the category of elements. I mean, I'm using the Yoneda lemma to identify a natural transformation from the representable from YA to X as use the same notation as a map from A to X, okay? So I write arrow from A to X, where A is an object of the category A, as the corresponding natural transformations, I write it like this. And by Yoneda, this is the same as an element in XA. So there is a category, the category of elements of X. The objects are pair AA, where A is index A, and morphism are a commutative triangle of this kind, should say A is in the category A. So this is a notation for this category, which Grothendieck use a lot. The category of elements of a functor is written by Grothendieck, element of X has a slice, is A over X. It's the category of representable objects mapping to X. This is the same thing. So you have this category of elements of a pre-sheaf, and there's a projection from A over X to A, and you can compose with the Yoneda functor, pre-sheaf on A, and so this is a projection. You get a diagram of representable indexed by the category of elements of A. Okay, so the category of elements of A is here. Of X is here. That's here. That's a typical object is like that. And the value of this functor at a given element is just Y of A. You forget the structure map. It's much small A, and you... Anyway, so every pre-sheaf is a canonical co-limit of representable. It's a miracle. I mean, I think that mathematics works on a certain number of miracles, in the sense that it happens that something becomes very, very simple, and we don't really know why it is so, but it's like the complex numbers, you know. It's very, very simple, but why is it there? I don't know. Without these simple facts, mathematics would be very hard or impossible. And it's one of the Yoneda lemma, and this fact that every pre-sheaf is a co-limit of representable in a canonical way makes life very easy for us mathematicians. Because if you want to extend continuously or co-continuously a functor, you use this formula here. Because if I have a functor which I want to extend, So I assume that the functor preserve colimit. So I will have the formula that if F preserve colimit, it will be the colimit of F of YA and with A to A, the same diagrams. I mean, if there is an a co-continuous extension, it will have to be that. But F of YA is by definition F, you see? So we see that it's the colimit . So we have a formula for extending an arbitrary functor into a co-continuous functor, and we see there that it's unique. I mean, there's a unique way to do that. So the category of pre-sheaf is the free co-completion of completions under colimits of a category. And I would like to think of this as the linearization of the category, because I want to think of suprema as sum. And I want to think of finite limits as product. Okay, so what I'm looking here is the linearizations of a category. This is very much like taking a set and embedding it into the linearizations of it, into the free abelian group generated by it. I'm sorry? Oh, right. Thank you. Here. Okay, so we have this linearization process. Now, do we have the other process, which is adding multiplication? You see, remember that a ring is made in two steps. From set, you take commutative monoid, and then rings. So we need to understand what is the first step of building the free category with finite limits. Okay, how do we build up the free category with finite limits from a given category? So in this case, it would be like cat with finite limits. And then here, actually, we go with the topos. Okay. So I'm going to tell you how to construct the free topos generated by a category. So at least we still don't know what a topos is. I didn't define it, but we will be able to construct the free topos. So how do we add finite limits to a category? Well, it is easier to add finite colimits. Because we know how to add all colimits. It's the unit embedding. This add all colimits. So in order to add finite colimits, you just need to take the subcategory of finitely presented pre-sheaves. Some pre-sheaves are finite colimits of representable. So a pre-sheaf is finitely presented, essentially, if it can be described by a colimit, a co-kernel of a finite co-product of a representable. So you take a finite coproduct here, finite coproduct there, and you take the co-equalizer, and that's what you get there, is a finitely pre-sheaf of finite presentation. Now, the category of pre-sheaves a finite presentation is actually closed under finite colimits. It's not difficult to check, okay? And the unit functor induces something here, which you could call the unit functor again, but it lands into a smaller category. And this is the free co-completion under finite colimits of A, which means that now, that if E is finitely co-complete under finite co-product and co-equalizer, and if you have a functor here, you will be able to extend your functor in a essentially unique way, unique up to unique as a morphism, to have a triangle which commutes up to canonical as a morphism. So we know how to co-complete a small category, co-complete under finite colimits. But what about completing other finite limits? Well, one of the marvelous things about categories, the notion is that every category has an opposite, right? It's a marvelous thing. I mean, before Allenberry MacLane, we had very few examples of duality, you see. But since every category has an opposite, we can always change it, and it's just an amazing thing. It's very trivial, but it's a very important process. So in order to co-complete under finite limits, so you take the opposite of A. I first take the opposite of B, and then I take its finite co-completion. Okay, and then I take the opposite. Okay, and from the unit functor, you will get the functor here, which you could call the unit again, but which is not exactly the unit. And this category has finite limits, and it is the free completions under finite limits. Okay, so maybe we should give it a notation. Jean, do you have a notation to suggest me? Okay. So I will pretend that it's like completing under join. You see, joins are finite and FEMA. Okay. No. Meet. Completing under meet. Okay. It could be mean hat big completions, right? Okay, this is bad. Okay. Okay. FLA. No? Finite limit. Not very inspiring. Okay. In which direction? And this direction? Yeah, but I will put the arrow in this direction. Okay. For the finite limit completion. Okay. Okay, thank you. That's...
But the problem of the notation is very difficult.
Yes, I agree. Notations are extremely difficult, and terminology also very difficult. Grothendieck was very good to find the right notations in the right terminology, and I have a lot of admiration. Now, what will be the free topos generated by a small category? Well, the free topos I did not even tell you what is a topos and what is the category of it. But the free topos generated by A will be the pre-sheaves, so the co-limit completion of the finite limit completion. I'm sorry?
All precise.
No, yeah, there is no topology because it's free. Topology comes when you want to make a quotient. Remember that in the case of frames, the quotient frames were in bijections with the nuclei. And so if you want to make a quotient, you need the analog of nucleus in this context, and this is exactly what the Grothendieck topology are providing. Now I should give you some axiom, the Giraud axioms or versions of Giraud axiom. Is this a monad? With a small problem, because you started with a small category and you land with a big one. A monad should be an endofunctor, but otherwise it's a monad. Okay.
There is a bit of a cheating, because morphisms of topos are geometric.
Yeah, I'm not finished. I did not. Yeah, sure. Yeah. You see, remember that morphisms between frame are maps that preserve suprema and meat. And meat are finite and fima. So the same thing for topos. So I will define what a topos is by giving Giraud axiom. You could use Giraud definition to define what a topos is. Giraud characterized topos in a certain way, so you could define this axiom definition presentable. Category E is a topos. If the following conditions hold. So the first one would be that pullback functors are co-continuous. The second axiom is that the following square is a pullback for A and B. So if you take the coproduct of two objects, A and B, and you look at the inclusion, and you take the pullback, you take the intersections of A and B into their coproduct, then that's the initial object, that's zero. So this is a pullback. And three, equivalence relations are effective. Which means that if you have an equivalence relation, it's always the equivalence relation of a map. I mean, it's always obtained by pulling back a diagonal, if you like. Okay, that's a version of Giraud axiom. It's not exactly the Giraud axiom, but I want to make some remark. The first axiom here is distributivity. You see, it's distributivity of pullback over co-limit. So, because what it says is that if you have a map from A to B, and if you have a diagram now, DI mapping to B. So D is a diagram from a small category to E over B. So you have a family of objects over B, and then you can take the colimit of the pullback, colimit, thank you, of the pullback. I'm sorry? Yeah, presentable category, fortunately, have limits. Presentable category have, by definition, colimits, but they have also all limits. All limits. You see, it's the analog of this theorem or result, elementary, that if you have a poset, which is a soup lattice, suprema, then it must have enfima.
You mentioned that before.
Yes, I mentioned this. And the exact analog of that is to say that a presentable category, which is actually defined as a category with colimit, has limits also. Okay, so this is why I can write here pullback. And there will be a canonical map from this to A, the colimit of the DI. And the condition is that this canonical map is an isomorphism. And you see that this is really a distributivity law, because, for example, if the colimit is a coproduct, you see, I'm saying that this is the same thing as the coproduct of A cross B over DI. No, I'm defining topos this way. It's equivalent to the classical notion. It's a theorem, right? It's a theorem. It's not obvious completely. It's essentially Giraud theorem, but that's one way of defining what a topos is. You may have other definition because there are many ways to characterize a topos. A co-consmus means preserving colimits. No. Forget about the definitions of the algebraic geometry. This is not what. That's equivalent. That's equivalent. I cannot prove it in this talk, but this definition here is equivalent to the classical notion. Okay? That's a theorem. So we can use this one if you like. If you don't like, you can use another one. But the reason I'm putting it here is that it clearly shows that the distributivity of finite limits and colimits plays an essential role in the notions of a topos. Okay? Now, what is a morphism, a geometric morphism? Actually, I'm working here not in the category of topos, but in the opposite category. It's a bit like working in the category of frames rather than the category of locale. So I'm going to define the algebraic notions of a topos. So, or the algebraic, okay. So a morphism, an algebraic morphism. Algebraic morphism of toposes let's say from E to E prime I, okay. It's a functor which preserves colimits and finite limits. That's it. No. This way. An algebraic morphism. Okay. So in this direction. An algebraic morphism of topos is a functor from E to E prime. It is a functor that takes...
That's why you are in the opposite.
Yes, and this category, I call it A top. It's like the category of rings. Let's see. A topos, okay? And
finite limits,
and arbitrary co-limits. And then there is the category of topos. Okay? The category is the opposite of that. Okay, so this is like here, then when we say that frame, opposite are locales, okay? Is the category of locales? Well, we do the same thing here. In other words, locales is kind of a fiction with respect to frames, because it's just obtained by reversing things upside down, okay? Well, topos are also fiction. They are just obtained by reversing algebraic topos upside down. And these things are rings, okay? And what is the proof of that? It's the fact that the constructions I just gave of the free topos works. In other words, if you take a category with finite limits, so this is like we know that this is the enveloping topos of the category with finite limits, in the sense that it has this universal property. Well, actually, this is a theorem. You take the unit R. Okay. And you have the appreciated category, so you start with the category. Now, you take a topos satisfying this condition. Take a topos satisfying these axioms, okay? Take the topos, okay. Now, the topos is here. And I take a functor that preserves finite limits. Okay? And then I know that there is a linear extension of it, which is what we saw before. It's the left-hand extension, the linear extension, F flourish. We extend it linearly. Just with the formula, extended, linear. Theorem, this functor is not only linear, it is multiplicative. It preserves finite limits. Okay? This is, in some sense, this should be, or this could be, the fundamental theorem of topos theory, but I don't want to say that, because it may be in SGA4, actually. I should check. There are so many things in SGA4, and I never read it systematically. I may have missed this, but it could be there. But really, what it says is that there is a distributivity law between arbitrary co-limits and finite limits, and from this distributivity law, the notions of topos, which is here, emerge. Okay, that's essentially the idea. And the theorem here is not... I think I will try to give a proof in the notes, but you may receive the note in a couple of months. I have a lot of things to do. But this theorem is kind of interesting to prove. Let me prove you an instance of it. I mean, let me show you why this preserves finite product. Exact. It's, we may say a functor preserving finite limits can be said to be left exact. So I'm okay. So I'm starting with. I'm sorry. Yes, exactly. See, okay. Okay. Yeah. It's a morphism of this type. It's an algebraic morphism of topos. It's a functor that preserves. Okay. So let me try to give you a quick proof of that, but it will be not complete. I will not prove that it preserves all pullback. I will just prove that it preserves product. And the proof is trivial. The difficulty is to show that it preserves all pullback, but for product, it's very easy. To preserve product, you want to show that f of if x cross y, that the canonical map to f of x cross f of y is an isomorphism. You want to show that this is an isomorphism for every x and y. Okay? So let's suppose that x and y are representable. Let's look at the case where f, x, and y are representable. So in this case, you have f of y a cross y b, and it goes into f of y a cross f y b. Okay, that's just a special case. But the product of two representable. Yeah. I'm finished. Yeah. So you want to show that this map. So in the case where you have a representable, this is y of a cross b, because since the category has finite limits, it has product, and the unidirectional functor preserve. So in fact, you are looking at a map like this, and this is f of a, and this is f of b, because f lower shriek extend. So you see, this is f of a cross b, going into f of a cross f of b, we are supposing that f is left exact. So this map is an isomorphism in the case of representable. Okay? Now, taking product, fixing one variable, preserve colimits. Okay? By distributivity. You see, by distributivity. So, there is a diagram here, and if you use the canonical colimit, y is a canonical colimit of yb, and you use the fact that this is an isomorphism, you fix one variable, you play with the other, and then you can't do it the same simultaneously. You have to do it one at a time. It's a functor of two variables, which is co-continuous in each, but not simultaneously continuous. You have to be careful about that. And the theorem is done, okay? The difficulty is to prove the general case. It's you have to slice, and there are something a bit more subtle. Here you see I have used very little of the axioms. Now, why is it fundamental as a result? I will be finished with that. It's just if you have topos in the sense that I have defined with the axioms, then since it is a locally presentable category, you can always find a subcategory A which is large enough so that the corresponding functor, just because it's locally representable from A to E, is a localization, which means that the right adjoint is fully faithful. That's just because E is, that's a general result for presentable category. You can always do that. Okay, once you have done that, what about if E is a topos? Well, in this case, you could choose A to be closed under finite limits. Okay, and then the inclusion has preserve finite limits. So the extension here, so let's call that F, the inclusion, the extension F star will preserve finite limits. It will be a geometric morphism of topos where the right adjoint, with a right adjoint, is fully faithful. Well, this is exactly the other definitions of what a topos is. It's a left exact localization of a topos. So that prove at the same time Giraud's theorem and etc. I guess I should stop here. Yes, thank you.